Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself Dr. Hanifa. Today I'll be talking on a very important topic called neonatal hearing screening, or you can also say as newborn hearing screening. So the topics which we are going to cover today is on the neonatal hearing screening, why this neonatal hearing screening is important. Then we'll have a look into the history of infant hearing screening. We'll discuss about universal newborn hearing screening, then the high-risk groups for the hearing loss in infants, what is the ideal time of screening, the different methods of screening, and we'll discuss also about the algorithm for the newborn hearing screening and the other test which is needed for the diagnosis of hearing loss in children. So, I hope that you know about screening. Screening means to test for infections or diseases in population or individuals who are not seeking health care. And the today's topic, that is the neonatal hearing screening, is an example of a screening. That means when we screen the newborns, as you can see here, we are screening with a OAE. So when we screen the newborns for the hearing, they are not coming for the hearing testing, but we are screening so that we can identify any hidden hearing loss in them. Then different examples from the today's topic, let me give you, is when we screen the blood donors for infections like retroviral infection, hepatitis B virus or hepatitis C virus, then that is also an example of screening. So today, before we begin our topic, I would like to share a quote by Madam Helen Keller. Madam Helen Keller, she was an educator, she was a lecturer and activist. So she lost her sight and hearing due to some illness at the age, very young age of 19 months. And she quoted, and that is a very deep quote. She told that the blindness cuts off from things, but deafness cuts off from people. She shared that it was not the blindness or the deafness that brought disappointment to her, but it was her inability to speak, because hearing shares a very close relation with the development of speech and the language. Why is neonatal hearing screening important? So we know that when a child is born, in newborns, they are routinely screened to detect treatable genetic and the developmental abnormalities if they are present. Examples, the newborns, they are routinely screened for diseases like hypothyroidism, and the screening of hearing in newborns is also a part of it. And the question is why it is important. The reason is because the hearing loss is still one of the significant burden for the society. Hearing loss, it has a close relation in the development of the speech and language. So hearing loss will definitely affect the speech and language, and it has a significant social and the psychological consequences. So when we are doing the neonatal hearing screening, it will reduce the impact on the speech, language, education, and on the further on the society. Moreover, remember, data shows that the hearing loss in children can be prevented. As per WHO data, the congenital hearing loss is more common than the other conditions the newborns are routinely screened for. So when we apply neonatal hearing screening as a protocol, this will help in early identification of the hearing loss. Now, the importance is that when they are identified early, then the habilitation also will be initiated early, isn't it? Because when the screening is not done, then the hearing loss in children will be diagnosed at a later age. And that means the studies shows that the hearing loss is identified after 12 to 14 months of age. And this hearing deprivation for the long period has a poor prognosis on the speech and the language outcomes. Now let's see a history about the infant hearing screening. So we'll go from the beginning. It was in the year 1969 that the Joint Committee on Infant Hearing, that is the JCIH, was established with the goal to develop more accurate and efficient methods of identifying neonatal hearing impairment. After a gap of 3 years, in around 1972, they recommended the use of high risk registry. That means to identify the infants who are at a higher risk of developing hearing loss. Then, and they recommended that for these high-risk infants, the audiological testing must be done. From the era 1982 to 1994, there was an upgradation or the update of the high-risk criteria. Then in the year 1994, JCIH recommended that all infants with hearing loss should be identified before 3 months of age and receive intervention by 6 months of age. And this is how the universal newborn screening came into existence. But do you know why they recommended the universal newborn hearing screening? Because when they studied their observation over the period of 2 decades, they found that about 95 to 98% of the neonates with one or more risk factors had normal hearing. And it was seen that 50% children with the profound or moderate hearing loss had no risk factors. That means if we go by the risk factors, there is a probability that we will miss the children with the hearing loss. And if we screen all the infants, then there is a very minimal chance of missing those susceptible group of children. So the universal newborn screening was implemented in many of the developed countries. This universal newborn hearing screening, it was the step taken to ensure early detection and the rehabilitation of the hearing loss. It was recommended by the National Institute of Deafness and Other Communicable Disorders in the year 1993. So their goal was to screen the newborns by the age of 1 month. The diagnosis should be done if there is any problem. The diagnosis should be made by age of 3 months, and the intervention and the treatment should commence by the 6 months of age. And as per WHO, this policy should be adopted in all the countries and communities with the available rehabilitation resources. But the problem is application of the strategy depends on many factors like resource, economy, availability of qualified healthcare services, and the legislative supports. And it is seen that this universal newborn hearing screening has become a standard practice in most of the developed countries. But there are some limitations of this screening. Now let's see. When we are talking about the facts about the universal hearing screening, you must also know about the limitations. Even after application of universal newborn screening, there is a possibility that the less severe hearing impaired children, less than 30 to 40 decibel of hearing, they may not be detected with the screening tools. Then if the child develops late onset hearing problem, or if the child has a progressive hearing loss, then they may remain undetected after birth. Then in infants with the auditory neuropathy, where when the screening is done with the otoacoustic emissions, they may not be detected. So even with the good strategy also, the some chunk of population may be missed. So we know that as per WHO, they recommended the implementation of the universal newborn hearing screening all over the world. If we talk about our country, India, then the effort to implement this program was initiated in the year 2006, when the government of India initiated the efforts towards the prevention and control of deafness, and in which the neonatal hearing screening was incorporated. So now when we are talking about the hearing screening, in most of the developing countries, the hearing screening is done for the high-risk groups. So now let us see what are the conditions which fall under high-risk group. So first is the family history of hereditary childhood sensory neural hearing impairment. Then intrauterine infections like prenatal infections like toxoplasmosis, rubella, cytomegalovirus, and herpes simplex infections. If the child had, then they must be screened. Presence of craniofacial anomalies, birth weight less than 1500 grams, then hyperbilirubinemia if it is severe enough, to require exchange transfusion. Then when the child has received ototoxic medications, presence of bacterial meningitis, Apgar scores 0 to 4 at 1 minute or 0 to 6 at 5 minutes, then mechanical ventilation for 5 days or longer, and other findings associated with the syndromes known to include sensorineural or conductive hearing loss, they fall under the high-risk groups. So you must know what is a high-risk group and where, when, where they must be screened. So what is the ideal time of hearing? So ideal time of hearing, if we follow the developed countries, they follow the formula 1-3-6. That means to screen the newborn before the 1 month of age. 3 months, they must be fitted with the hearing aids. That means they must be diagnosed and they must be fitted with the hearing aids. And by 6 months, they must be enrolled for the intervention. Now, for the neonatal hearing screening, what are the different methods of screening or the testing tools? For any screening, we need some investigations, we need some testing tools. So a testing stool or a screening tool, they must satisfy some basic criteria. The first criteria is that they must be acceptable to the patients. That means they must be non-invasive, rapid, reliable, and easy to use. Then second is the validity. They must give a valid result, and the validity has two components: specificity of the test and the sensitivity of the test. And the testing stool for the neonatal hearing screening, they must give response specific to the peripheral auditory system, and the response must be robust. Then second is the third component of a testing screening tool is the repeatability. That means they must give consistent result when they are repeated more than one in the same individual under the same operating conditions. So for the newborn hearing screening, there are two options. One is OAE, that is autoacoustic emissions, or ABR, that means auditory brainstem response. For knowing into details about OAE and ABR, please go through our video. Now, coming to the question, since we have two options, OAE and ABR, now what is the choice of testing tool? So see, the testing tool, it differs in countries according to the economy and according to the available facility and resources. The testing methods different are TEOAE, that means transient evoked autoacoustic emissions. AABR means automated auditory brainstem response, and DPOAE means distortion proportion OAE. So here you can see that the screening of a newborn is being done with the instrument, and this instrument is using DPOAE response. So here you can see that there is a tick mark, it is showing pass, and this is the way of doing the OAE testing in a newborn. But in most of the developed countries, they use automated ABR in the neonatal ICU. So this is a graph of a ABR. Now, since we know that there are two tools, OAE and ABR, so what is best? So remember that no test is perfect. In the beginning, when the neonates were screened for the hearing, that time the ABR was used. But with the advancement nowadays, this ABR is automated ABR. So in most of the developed countries in NICU, they are using automated ABRs. But the OAE is a screening tool of choice for most of the countries. The reason is it takes less time than ABR, because for doing the ABR, it needs a longer time because of the electrode placement and all. Then the OAE, it gives cochlear specific information. It provides information over the broader frequency range than the click evoked ABR. When we are doing the screening with the OAE, we can either use DPOAE or the transient evoked OAE. And it is seen that the DPOAE gives a robust response in infants and the neonates. So here we will see about the how to go about a newborn hearing screening. So when we do the screening with the OAE, we may get the response either as pass. As you can see here in this graph, it is written DPOE pass, and we are getting the responses over the three frequencies. And we may get a response like this where it is written no valid OAE and we are not getting any response. So this time, this is called refer or non-pass. So what do you mean by pass? When we are doing a OAE and when you get a pass, that means that the hearing loss was not found at birth. But remember, it does not rule out future hearing loss because every testing tool has its limitations. So when we are getting a pass, that means at that moment the infant is not having any issues. Then what do you mean by refer? Refer means that the further testing is needed. When we get a pass, no further testing is needed. When we get a refer, that means that the parents must be counseled that the child needs further testing. But also counsel the parents that refer does not necessarily means that the baby is having hearing loss. So when we get a refer in OAE, we have to do an ABR. So in ABR, we may get pass. Pass means when we are able to detect the hearing thresholds, when we are getting all the waves 1, 3 and 5 and we estimate the hearing thresholds, pass means then again no further testing is needed. But again, if you are getting ABR refer, that means you are finding that the hearing thresholds is higher up, then we have to do the further testing. So now let us see this graph. In this ABR pass, you can see that the wave 5, which is the most reliable wave to determine the hearing thresholds, it is seen at about 30 dB NHL. So this is an ABR of an infant who was screened. Now let us see the supplementary test which is needed for the diagnosis of hearing loss when we are getting an ABR refer. We'll just go through, we'll not discuss in details. So you must know that such type of children or babies, in those cases, the radiological test must be done. That is the HRCT temporal bone to know about the anatomy of the inner ear. Then the genetic counseling must be done. Hematological tests like CBC must be done. Then they must be tested for cytomegalovirus workup, ESR, anti-cardiolipin antibody and complement study to rule out any immunological cause of hearing loss. Thyroid function test must be done. Then to test for any metabolic disease, the urine must be tested for glycosamine glycans. Renal test like urine analysis, and among the cardiac test, we have to do the ECG. So these are the tests we have to do whenever we are getting an ABR refer. So with this, I would like to conclude and thank you for watching MBBS classes.